So this week we are going to stay in plyometrics. Last week we kind of talked about the physiology and the structure and function and how those kind of come together to produce these explosive movements. Today we're actually going to talk about program design, so how we design plyometric training. Before we get started, we'll just give kind of a brief fun history. Again, in the realm of things, plyometrics are a relatively young way of training. It was kind of really started in the Soviet Union in the 60s and didn't make its way over to the US until the 70s and earlier part of the 80s. So again, if you compare that to like strength or endurance training, where this has been going on for centuries, quite a bit different. So how did plyometrics come about? Well, there was a Soviet scientist back in the 70s. That's right, we're going to see a video, cue the Rocky music, as I know you're all playing in your head already. Don't worry, it's in there. But there's a Russian trainer by the name of Yuri Verkhoshansky, and he is known as the father of modern-day plyometrics. And as I explain this, you're going to go, well, man, why did it take so long for us to actually get this idea of training in? So essentially what he did is what, you know, we should be doing now at all points of time. So analyzing movements in his athletes and then trying to optimize the training for that. And of course, one thing that he noticed was that, you know, in between movements, what he really saw is there was this idea of this shock. So, you know, in the previous videos, we gave the idea of a runner, so that the idea that you have that eccentric contraction that happens when you land, and if you kind of zoomed in on that and kind of looked at the forces that were going on, his idea was there was this huge shock that was happening to the muscle, to the bone, to the bodies, that the body was absorbing, and then using the biomechanics, using that to kind of propel itself forward. And so he looked at that and kind of saw that this was a way that maybe we should be training. Maybe we should be recreating these really intense shock-type movements into his training. And so in the mid-60s, he came up with this program, again, in the Soviet Union. That's right, Rocky movies abound. And kind of started using this. And his classic way of doing it was to utilize ultra-intense, very low volume and frequency, really long rest periods in order to kind of do really high force output. We've changed things a little bit, so now we've gotten some modern principles, and some, you know, hardcore Verkhoshansky guys think that, you know, as Americans now, we've butchered the name of plyometrics and calling anything that's using some type of power movement of plyometrics when it's not quite, but I kind of disagree with that, as does the NSCA, and so we'll talk about that and different things that we can do. So one of the things that he really used in his training was the idea of something called a box jump. So the box jump is kind of the modern day. What he called it was depth jumps, and we kind of have a video, an image here, and then I'll play a quick little Verkhoshansky video. So that we can get our Rocky music in, of course. But here's the idea of a depth, or as you can see, it's called a box jump because you have a box. I don't love this image, but it's the best. The easiest way to think about it is look at the video here in about 50 seconds during the YouTube clip. I'll mark it in the in there of the depth jump. But ultimately, what you do is you essentially come off in a relaxed position. So this guy should be relaxed, right? As he steps off, he will then fall. And as soon as he lands, he would explosively then perform a jumping movement, right? The idea is to spend minimal time on the ground here. Again, minimizing that amortization phase. So we have our eccentric phase of landing and coming down, and then our concentric phase of explosively jumping, with our amortization phase, as we discussed from the last lecture, trying to minimize this to try to keep it less than, you know, about 0.23, 0.25 seconds or so. Right. another point that I'll kind of point out is that one thing that you can think about is going through this box jump or depth jump is that when you fall, This is probably in the jumping phase. So I highlight the relaxed because this is going to translate to most plyometrics is that when you're doing them, you need to minimize the shock absorption. So in this example of a depth jump, you need to not have a flex knees and minimized hip flexion to which would kind of be absorbing that shock. Instead, you want a high shock on the system so that you get that stored loading phase into the tendons and stretch those muscle spindles so that you can explode. So if we look here, here's a graph that just kind of shows the importance of these plyometric or shock movements is the idea that you generate a lot more peak force. So, here's just a bend at the knee and then jump. So kind of your stationary, no kind of recoiling or preparation to jump, just starting at a bent knee and jump, and then the height, which would be an analysis of about power output. We can then look at a counter movement, so where we go down and then up, countering the movement, and we can generate more force. But here, if we look at the depth jump where we step down and then reflexively jump up using this kind of plyometric idea, you can get an even greater height or greater peak power output. So we're going to watch a little bit of the Verkhoshansky old school video just to get you in the mood, and then we're going to talk about some of the program designs.
Plyometrics. Plyometrics has a relatively short history. It originated with the Soviets back in about 1958. Verkhoshansky was the gentleman who developed what we call a depth jump, which will be described. And that gave me the idea to use various kinds of jumps. Explosiveness, but first you need a strength base. Because it is very vigorous and very taxing on the body. And with this, they developed a very scientifically based training program. The way they train is quite a bit different from what we've been doing in the United States.
So now you're a little bit caught up on history, have seen some kind of very classic and kind of old school video of the types of movement that we're talking about. Again, I kind of encourage you guys to use the resources at hand. So just kind of Google some exercises for plyometrics, look them up. ACSM has some good ones. NSCA, you can look on their website and kind of get some ideas to kind of see how these are done. So what we're going to talk about now is working through how do we design and implement a training program using plyometrics. What you're going to see is this is going to be, of course, very similar to our design and implementation of a strength program as we went, right? So the first thing that we need to do is, of course, a needs analysis. And our needs analysis will follow those exact same criteria that we followed before so that we kind of get a better understanding of both what the athlete needs, what they are trying to accomplish, their goals, get an idea of the demands of the sport, get an idea about injury history. That's going to be, of course, be very important with these high intensity plyometric type exercises, and kind of work through that, right? So beyond just kind of getting to understand the person and what they're doing, ultimately we can then be able to establish sport, position, and specific athletic goals that they want to reach. Right. Once we've analyzed that, we can then start to mess with the variables. And again, just like the resistance training, our program design variables are going to be very similar, right? So we can have the mode of exercise or type of exercise that we're doing, the intensity, right? We can look at frequency. One that we didn't talk a ton about in the resistance training session would of course be recovery time is going to be very important here, our volume, and then another thing that we'll think about is the program length. So we'll kind of address each of these variables in their own. Right. The other thing that I want to talk about is that when you start to implement a training program is to, what you always see is teach proper technique, but I like to use the phrase teach and preach, right? Because ultimately the quality of the training is the most crucial, right? As we're thinking about these plyometrics, these are trying to generate huge power outputs, maximal power outputs during each repetition. So therefore, we need to have each rep performed with maximal effort. So therefore, as we kind of think about these, we need to not only teach them how to do them correctly, but be monitoring and making sure that fatigue isn't a problem, that they're having adequate recovery, and we'll get to those variables. So you'll hear me use teach and preach, proper technique, really important in these max effort contractions. And then the last is, again, just like resistance training, we need to have some type of progression such that we increase one or more of these variables as the training proceeds. So we'll start with the first one, which is mode. For plyometrics, we really have two. If you have read or looked through the book, the NSCA, the book that they put out, kind of recommends or puts three categories in. I'll talk about my biases against that, but the way I think about it is two, and so you can see I've kind of developed the slide here. So we have one upper body and or one lower body and two upper body, right? So lower body plyometrics are essentially appropriate for almost any athlete in any single sport, whether it's football or basketball or soccer or track. The majority of our athletic achievements are going to involve some type of power generation by our legs, right? And so these are going to be probably the most common that you're going to be putting into any program that you may be designing. Right. We can design them then specifically based on sport, again, utilizing that needs analysis by understanding what type of direction of movement in that sport. And so maybe it's a movement in a horizontal plane, such as something like a football player, a football lineman, or we can think of something in a vertical component, which is predominantly would be a lot of basketball players in a jump. Of course, both football and basketball have movements in those other areas, but those are just two examples. So we can look at maximal, vertical. We can also look at lateral, kind of looking into developing a bit of power and agility. We'll get into agility here soon. But just being able to understand those. One other thing that I'll note is that we can also improve endurance training with plyometrics, or sorry, not endurance training, but endurance athletes. That I think kind of gets lost in the fold a little bit is when we think about these max exercises that we're developing these power athletes. But endurance can benefit as well, so we can improve foot speed with plyometrics in long distance runners, in cyclists can see improved performance as well with these. So it's not just these power athletes, but again, appropriate for virtually any athlete in any sport. Upper body, these are again usually performed with things such as medicine ball throws or catches. There's different types of push-ups. These are going to be, you know, less appropriate for all athletes. We really need to think about types of athletes. So, for example, a runner doesn't really need to do upper body plyometrics, but a good example of someone who might would be, say, a pitcher or a volleyball player would be two people who would benefit greatly from these upper body plyometrics. The third, I'm going to put a question mark here because the physiology and the research says that this doesn't really occur. So trying to do plyometrics with our trunk or our core muscles. Right. The reason that the research kind of looks at this is that ultimately it says that the elements that we need in order to have this work aren't present. So it's clearly demonstrated that the flex, the stretch flex reflex using muscle spindles doesn't really occur. There's a handful of theories of why that is. One theory being that since it's closer to the spinal cord, that response time is so much shorter, and so we can't actually cut down the amount of time in between the stretch and the the stretch and the reflex contraction. The other thing is usually we need some type of range of motion that needs to be relatively small in our movements, and our trunk actually has an extremely large range of motion going completely around for certain exercises, and this isn't incompatible with plyometrics, and so the NSCA does have kind of their ideas and thoughts, and so since this since we are kind of following a little bit of the CSCS platform, I will say that this is not, or that they do suggest that you can kind of plyometrically alter some exercises for the trunk that maybe are able to kind of replicate or kind of just generate those movement patterns, and whether or not you're getting true plyometrics is argued by people who are much more involved in this than me, but we're going to go with what they say. So again, to do this, they need really short, quick, shorter and quicker movements in order to allow stimulation of the stretch reflex, shorter to decrease that range of motion, and quicker to kind of still engage those muscle spindles. Again, toss up on whether or not that occurs. We're going to stick with, you can modify them kind of, since that's what the NSCA says. So you can pick your exercises, of course, and those are going to really determine a lot of other things. So we'll get into intensity next, because ultimately intensity is going to be very much controlled basically by the type of drill that you do. So we can alter simply the intensity by, I kind of created this little metric of going from left to right in less intense to intense, the way that you can kind of envision this is that intensity is ultimately going to be amounted to the amount of stress placed on muscles. One thing I want to note is that intensity here isn't necessarily the percent effort, right? So when we were talking in resistance training, that's really how we quantified it. So intensity would be something like 85% of one rep max, or 90% of one rep max, or a low intensity might be 30% of one rep max. That's not the case in plyometrics. Plyometrics is, in general, max intensity for, or max effort for everything, right? Again, max effort, giving it all you can. So we adjust intensities instead by changing the type of drills in which we do, right? And that's by changing the amount of stress placed on muscles. So what I've kind of worked it in here is the idea that we have kind of in-place jumps would be the lowest intensity because it puts the least amount of stress, right? So this is low stress. We can then move to standing jumps, then to putting multiple jumps in a row, where we could maybe do a zigzag jump would be an example if you've done many plyometrics. Then we can go to bounding, and then our highest intensity, which is going to put the most, is box drills. So this is high stress. And our box drills, again, one of the reasons that I kind of showed that. So again, this is our classically our depth jump or something here. So again, maximal effort given at all of these, whether it's an in-place jump or box drill. So when we think of intensity, again, the idea of stress placed on muscles is how we alter intensity, not by a percent effort here, right? In general, when we talk about recovery and rest and how many sets and reps we should do, in general, we'll say that as intensity increases, the harder you get over here, then the amount of volume that you're doing should decrease, right? One other way that we can ultimately increase intensity, again, to really show that this is a percent effort, is we can add some external loading. So you can use something like dumbbells, or you can use a weighted vest, or even you'll see that people will do these with barbells as well. And so the key point to stress from this is intensity is really determined by how much stress you're placing on the muscles, isn't determined by a percent of a maximal effort. Right. So if we think about factors also affecting lower body, so one of the things we're going to talk about this more is the idea of points of contact, or how many times your feet touch the ground. If you're doing single, then it's 1 foot. If you're doing like two-legged, then it's both feet would just count as one. Right. We can also think about the speed. The greater the speed, the intensity of the drill. The height, this comes from, again, the idea of box jumps. So one way we can increase the box jump is by increasing the height of the box, which will, the higher you go, the faster you fall when you land, the more stress you put then on your bodies, and the then greater the intensity. Again, going with that, body weight, the more you weigh, the faster you fall. The faster you fall, the more intense you are. So those are all factors that will ultimately affect the intensity. Right. We can also look at frequency. Frequency, a lot of times, is in general pretty conservative. So I want you guys to really think about this. Is in general, we try not to encourage plyometrics to be done super, super often. Typical recovery guideline is at least 48 to 72 hours. I would lean in this category here. If you were personally to ask me, if I was designing a program for you, I would definitely lean in that 72 hours in between plyometric session, right? So therefore, 72 hours, usually performing anywhere between 2 to maybe 3 plyometric sessions per week, right? Of course, this can be training and or the timing dependent, right? So as you might think, if you're out of season, of course, this could be where you are maybe trying to improve power and strength, and so maybe you want to do 3 times per week, and then maybe as you move into the season, when you're designing the program for an in-season program, that you want to kind of dial that back some, and maybe only do 1 time a week. So the frequency, you'll read that most of the kind of textbooks, they say frequency important, recovery much more important. So that's what they really stress in the frequency, and that's why I lean towards that 3 days is order to get full recovery. One thing that I will note, and you'll hear me say a couple times, so for most of this stuff, there isn't a lot of great research that goes in and kind of altering one variable at a time and looking at that. So as I mentioned, this is kind of a newer, more novel training program, and so there isn't a ton of, you know, I went in and we altered, so in the strength training, right, we would go in and there was plenty of studies that showed some great data, which shows like what happens to, you know, the ability to, you know, hypertrophy and strength gains if you have 30 seconds in between sets, all the way up to 1 minute to 3 to 5 minutes, you know, something like that. Those studies don't exist in plyometrics, and so a lot of this is kind of just based on personal opinion, right? So when we think of recovery, I would say err on the side of caution. It's not, you know, kind of crazy to have a 5 to 10 second rest in between reps of plyometrics and in between sets, 2 to 3 minutes or more. Again, I'm on the conservative side. You'll see me recommending to recover giving about 3 minutes per set. When you're looking at exercises, again, we're not going to go through a ton of exercises. One thing that I'll say is if you get your exercises from a reputable site, a lot of times they will give you a proper rest to work to rest ratio in somewhere in between like a 1 to 5 or a 1 to 10. This is of course going to be specific to the volume and type of drill being performed, right? And so if it's a really intense workout, maybe we want to stretch out that work to rest ratio to be higher. Less intense, we can of course dial that back. One thing that again goes into this, and why I talk about this 5 to 10 seconds erring on that side of a little bit longer, you know, it's kind of odd to think about having these huge rests if you aren't familiar with doing plyometrics. But one thing that is important to point out that drills should not be thought of as cardiorespiratory fitness, right? We're not trying to train them to be endurance athletes. These are power training, and so we want maximal effort. That's the entire concept. They're not training to improve aerobic fitness. They are training to improve power. So as long as we can get max effort, that's what we want. Okay. And then, of course, as we mentioned with frequency, if you're doing a given body area, don't perform them 2 days in a row. That fits with our recovery and our frequency. So the other thing that we can alter then, and the last one we'll talk about, is volume. Volume is essentially, you know, how many reps times sets. And again, not a lot of research out there to kind of sum this up, to give us great ideas for volume. As we mentioned earlier, as intensity increases, volume can kind of be backed down. The way that most people who are training plyometrics, the way that they explain it is by using foot contacts. So here you can see the volume that we're going to do, of course, is going to be based on what type of athlete we have, right? So we can express them as foot contacts, as I previously kind of breezed through earlier. You know, that could be one-legged, or if you're doing 2 feet at a time, that could be as each one lands, right? If we're talking about upper body, we can calculate it as number of throws or number of catches. Or if you're doing distance drills, you can alter it by distance. Again, this is going to be very dependent on the type of exercise that you're going to use. So the advice that NSCA gives, and what we'll stick to, and what I just kind of suggest you guys learning and knowing, is that, you know, if we think about foot contacts for a beginner who isn't familiar with plyometrics, they need to keep their volume low, so between 80 to 100 foot contacts. Intermediate, more, 100 to 120, and advanced, 120 into 140. Right. So as you can see, these aren't going to be super long sessions, at least as number of reps and sets, when you're talking about multiple of these to give us maximal power.